know about the compensation program. No one I knew had ever heard of it. Not only do doctors not recognize the injury, even if they did, they don't even know that there's a way to report it. You know, they might just call what I've been told is that, oh yeah, I've called Merck or I've called Glaxo, so they report it to the drug company. You know, I'm not sure that's doing any good. Mm-hmm. And I distinctly remember seeing children coming in the emergency room without, you know, turning with codes, meaning they'd stopped breathing or had a seizure in the evening of the day they'd been in the clinic receiving their vaccinations. How can doctors even report it when they don't know there's a reporting system? I mean, if I trained in pediatrics and I didn't know, and I was at a good place.
Similarly, I was a board-certified emergency physician, and I was the director of an ER for 12 years. And that was many years before I knew anything about vaccines. I used to give out tetanus shots like they were some special form of candy. A little is good, a little bit more won't hurt them. Better to do that than let them get a tetanus shot. However, I grew up in a chiropractic family, and I came from three generations of chiropractors. I wasn't vaccinated when I was growing up. I had measles, mumps, rubella, chickenpox, pertussis. So did all of my cousins. So when kids would come into the ER, as you would know, and they were maybe behind on their vaccines, they weren't up to where the schedule should be, the nurses would always come to me and say, they're behind, should we catch them up? And I would always look at the nurses and say, they got a fever, leave them alone. They don't need any stuff injected into them. And the nurses would always look at me like I had three heads. What do you mean? This is an opportunity to vaccinate, which, as you know, that's what the industry says, that when you have a child in front of you and they're behind on the vaccines, that you must capture them and catch them up. And there are many case reports of kids that have gotten 10, 11, 13 vaccines all at the same time because they may not come back to the clinic for any more. And while you've got the opportunity, you must vaccinate them. So long before I knew any of the things that I knew now, I knew that something wasn't right. But how doctors are trained to think is that if a child has a vaccine reaction, there must be something wrong with that child. Mm-hmm. And I can remember cases of my own that just broke my heart. I can remember the moms that would come in the morning carrying their dead babies from what was then labeled SIDS and say, my child just had vaccines yesterday. Do you possibly think it had anything to do with it? And in my head, I would go, well, I don't know. I don't think so, but wow, it must have been something wrong with that kid if they just had vaccines and something happened. I can, off the top of my head, remember three or four children that parents came charging into the ER with them seizing in their arms that they had just left the family doctor or pediatrician's office and they just had their vaccines 20 minutes previously. Mm-hmm. And the parents would look at me with sad eyes and say, they just had their vaccines. Did that have anything to do with it? And I would walk away and go, wow, maybe something was wrong with that kid if they couldn't handle those vaccines. I remember the one father I put in jail over shaken baby syndrome. Which was the person that I will never forget, as I am looking in the eyes of his child and thinking, feeling very pompous about identifying shaken baby syndrome and watching the police haul this gentleman away handcuffed behind his eyes. I will go to my grave remembering that look on his face, knowing now what I know. And to think, here's his child who's dying, and I'm the one who put him in jail. And that's the reason why. Like, people will ask me, why is it that doctors don't get it? Why do pediatricians not get it? And I will always say it's because they'll have to do their own forgiveness work. Because they'll walk into their chart room and they'll look across those charts and go, wow, asthma, allergies, eczema, ADD, ADHD, seizure disorder, SIDS, cancer, rheumatoid arthritis,
diabetes.
Maybe I played a role in that. Maybe that was me. By injecting all of those kids and ignoring the signs and ignoring when the parents would call me and tell me they were crying and saying, oh, that's normal. They're just going to cry. It just hurt. And if they really realized what they were doing to destroy the human race and the DNA of humanity, they would have to stop, drop to their knees and say, God, forgive me, and turn around and do something different. And they would have to do that forgiveness work, which most physicians I don't think are capable of doing.
I think you're right. I mean, I grapple with the time I was a resident in pediatrics in the clinic, having to give vaccine after vaccine, and then working on call in the evening in the ER and seeing in those two cases the kids come back who they had stopped breathing and coding and they went to the ICU and I really don't even know what happened and I don't know that I wanted to know. And I think back now, and thank God in my own private practice I didn't do that. I went more into consulting integrative practice where, you know, that wasn't what I wasn't doing primary care pediatrics.
The shocking thing to me was when I was doing all of the research that I've done for vaccines, on, I put over 18,000 hours of my life, somewhere between 6P and 2A, on many, many nights, sitting there burning the midnight oil, of looking up all these vaccines and reading about them. And it started with, I went to the National Vaccine Information Center meeting in Washington, D.C. in September of 2000, sat there for 4 days and listened to parents and PhDs and doctors and giving all these testimonials. And there were about 700 people there and kids in wheelchairs. And I was like, how did I miss this? At this point in time, I've been in conventional medicine for 15 years. I've been doing integrative medicine for 7 years. How did I miss this sector of my education? So I went home and I started reading. I started with the general recommendations of vaccination, the 1998 version of the CDC paper that comes out every 2 years and updates. And it was a really poorly written, well done. I was like, you can't be serious. An entire industry came off of this, which was a 42-page paper that I said, maybe there's something else. Maybe I'm reading the wrong thing. Right. So I read and read and read, and I read Pediatric Infectious Disease Journal and JAMA and New England Journal, and I pulled all the World Health Organization documents. I read all the CDC documents. In fact, I read the CDC documents to the point where I called up several of the researchers and told them there were errors in their paper they needed to correct, and they thanked me. I said I should have sent them a bill.
Really?
So at one point in the middle of the night, somewhere along the line, I got to reading about pertussis, and it was in the Pediatric Pink Book, the 6th edition, and there was a sentence in there that I'll never forget. And I'll summarize it by saying that they said in this book, since there is no syndrome of vaccine injury, that when a child experiences something like myoclonic jerks, seizures, and even SIDS, that was a problem with the child that was going to be precipitated anyways. It was only by chance that it occurred when the vaccine was given. And at that point, it was 2 o'clock in the morning. It was a Norman Rockwell moment, little snowflakes coming down outside. And I just started to cry. And I thought, this is what physicians really believe, that even SIDS, even a death because of a defective child, was going to occur anyways. And it's only by chance that that occurred around the time a vaccine was given. And that's where this whole concept about temporal association does not prove causality, exactly, which in common language means that two things occurring at the same time, one doesn't necessarily cause the other.
Unless it's alternative medicine.
Unless it's something really horrific. You know, you got run over by a truck, it was probably the truck. But if you got a vaccine and you had an injury, well, it couldn't have been the vaccine.
No, but if you got a vitamin and you died, we know it would be all over the news that that's what killed. You know, I mean, the fact that a child just recently died, a healthy 19-year-old just died from a flu vaccine, coma within a day, coma for 28 days, dead. It's not on national news. It was just in the local news. If that child was put into a coma from, you know, a sports drink or a supplement or vitamin.
If that child had gone into a coma because of the influenza and hadn't had a flu
shot.
Oh,
my God, it would be all over the
news. It would be all over the news.
All over the news. Yeah. But, and that doesn't even happen, because all the flu deaths that I've looked at, the few pediatric flu deaths, sometimes they die from perforated intestinal tract. Well, the flu doesn't do that. And you look at what was being given to the kid, and the kid's on Advil every few hours and then dies of Advil and steroids and all kinds of things. And then you find out the actual cause of death was a perforated intestinal tract, and it's going down as a flu death because the kid had the flu. Mm-hmm. Or an upper respiratory tract infection, which might not have even been influenza. But, you know, your story is very moving and brave of you to be able to look at that and say, oh my God, I was part of that. I was participating. And two, even recognize that and be able to reckon with yourself, you know, that you vaccinate all these kids, and it's a tough thing to do. And I think that doctors do, in general, want to do the right thing.
So many times we want to blame the pharmaceutical industry, that they're the big bad guys. They just make the widget. If the doctor wasn't writing the prescription, if the doctor wasn't giving the order, nothing would happen. So I'm not quite so generous to the doctors who saying they always want to do the right thing. I think that they goose-step to the wrong drummer, and that they are amiss, maybe even lazy, that they don't take the time to do something as simple as read a package insert. And when parents will say something like, "Doctor, do you know what's in that syringe? Name me three ingredients." Mm-hmm. They can't.
No, they can't.
And so the parent, I think, logically would say, well, if you don't know what's in it, why should I allow you to inject that into my child or, as an adult, inject it into me? In my opinion, physicians are the problem. That if they would stand up for their patients and stop stuffing them full of drugs and stop injecting them and doing nothing more than suppressive medicine to cover up symptoms, we could have a complete revolution in healthcare and get back to why you and I went to medical school to begin with. Because we wanted to help people. Mm-hmm. We were fascinated by this thing called the body. Mm-hmm. We liked that biochemistry and physiology and anatomy and all those things that we did in high school, which made us decide we wanted to do pre-med in college and go to medical school. And instead, doctors are turning out to be nothing more than glorified drug reps. They have a degree and they have permission to write words on pieces of paper and hand them out for a living and make hundreds of thousands of dollars a year doing it. I'm not quite so generous in saying that they always want to do the right thing. I'm really not.
And like you, when I started getting onto this and researching in my master's program, years after my doctorate, I would be up at 2, 3 in the morning. I felt like I was falling down a rabbit hole. Really, that's what I likened it to. Oh my God, I've fallen down a rabbit hole. I keep opening a box, and now it just opened another box. I do agree that the doctors, they're trying to see as many people as they can throughout the day.
I get it.
Because that's, you know, I get that part. That's not how I practice, that's not how you practice, but it's how most doctors practice.
But you know what? It's the easy excuse.
It is the easy excuse.
I'm too busy. I'm seeing 50 patients a day. I'm working 12 hours a
right.
day. It's all I can do to keep up with my own industry, my own internal medicine journals. I don't have time to look outside the box.
And they need to, because really, you could say I'm working 12 hours a day, I'm seeing 50 patients, but are you helping them? If you're really not helping them, what's the point?
Exactly.
What is the point? But there are levels of fraudulent marketing on the part of the pharmaceutical industry. I mean, I'll give the doctors this much. The level of conniving and shenanigans is so deep and so complicated because things are misrepresented all the time. And you're right, the doctors are just glorified drug pushers, drug salesmen, because we now allow direct-to-consumer advertising on the part of the drug industry, which is a huge mistake, I personally believe, and I know many people believe that. And you've got the patient coming to the doctor knowing exactly what they want.
When I first decided that it was at least equally the problem of the physicians and not just the pharmaceutical industry, which back about maybe 10 years ago, there was a lot that was happening in the news about Ritalin. And I remember there was a young boy, maybe 10, 12 years of age, that he was skateboarding in Michigan. Mm-hmm. And he was on a skateboard and he fell over dead with a heart attack. And this young boy had been on Ritalin like his entire life. And suddenly there were other types of cases like that. So I started doing some investigation and I was like all mad at the drug companies about Ritalin and Adderall and all of those kinds of drugs. And then I did something really simple. I read the package insert. And the package insert says right in the PDR, I pulled it up, that said that nobody under the age, this should never be given to anyone under the age of 5, and it should never be given for longer than 60 days. And here's kids and teenagers that have been on it for a decade.
A decade or two.
So then I'm wondering, now at the time, I was still working part-time in the ER at that point, I'm thinking, when young people come in with chest pain, should one of the risk factors we be asking about is when you were younger, were you on Ritalin or Adderall or any of these other pharmaceuticals that are really stimulatory and can cause a lot of problems? Because they're legalized amphetamines. They're legal amphetamines. And so at that point in time, I just sat back in my chair and said, but the doctors wrote the prescriptions. And they renewed those prescriptions and they filled them year after year after year after year after year. And they obviously didn't read the package insert.
Obviously.
And they have no concern about any long-term consequences of this.
Well, we see this with proton pump inhibitors.
Exactly.
I mean, they say in the insert not to be given for what, I think, more than 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. And people come to my office with all these gastrointestinal problems and allergies and autoimmune disease, and it all dates back to when they, you know, a few weeks into their proton pump inhibitors.
That they've been on for a decade.
Right. And the same thing with the flu vaccine for pregnant women. The DTaP for pregnant women.
Now they're
the inserts. What do the inserts say?
Now they're talking about Gardasil for pregnant women. Even for children.
I read that was in the pipeline, recommended for day one of life. And I don't know if they're going to vote on it. It was just brought up. But to even think about that?
It's horrific. See, I really believe that at some point in time in the future, probably not in my lifetime or in your lifetime, but at some point in the future, social anthropologists are going to look back at us at this point in time in history and look at what we have injected into our children in the name of keeping them healthy. Animal cells, animal DNA, human DNA, formaldehyde, detergents, viruses, parts of bacteria, polysorbate 80, borax, all sorts
Aluminum,
mercury, all of those things that are known carcinogens into our children to keep them healthy, that I think that some social anthropologist is going to go, what were they thinking? And that this entire industry needs to go the way of bloodletting, leeches, and trephination when they used to drill holes in the skull and let out the evil spirits. That they're going to look at this, that this was all about commerce. It was all about money. And it was all about the destruction of the human race. And I personally believe that we're about one generation away of having completely corrupted the human DNA to the point of no return. And that we are going to be so pharmaceuticalized, it's going to be the point of no return.